Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Horrors of the House of Wills, a true story of a paranormal investigator's most terrifying case, by Daryl Marston, narrated by Gary Tiedemann. Publisher's note: this audiobook includes bonus material, including the appendix of the book. Please visit tantor.com and type Horrors of the House of Wills into the search box. Follow the link to the book's page. Then, under the Supplemental Content section, please enter the access code HAUNTED, and then click the Unlock button to access the bonus material. The code should be entered in all lowercase letters. Disclaimer: it is punishable by law to enter any property without permission from the property's owner. The author and publisher do not condone trespassing under any circumstance. Some of what you are about to hear in this story may be disturbing. Introduction. Every paranormal investigator is asked, "Where's the scariest place you've ever investigated?" There's always one location that gets to you, follows you home, and beckons you to come back, even though the thought of it gives you chills, and you've told yourself not to think about it. From the get-go, mine was always Fort Delaware. It was my first investigation, and was where I had my first real paranormal experience. It still calls me back. But we all have that one location that shakes an investigator to our core. If it hasn't happened yet, it will. And when it does, it quite possibly can make or break you, if you let it. This location almost broke me, in more ways than one. I was torn if I should write my story and tell it as it happened. It's been 6 years since my terrifying night, and I still remember it like it was just hours ago. I buried a lot of my memories of it deep down inside of me. At first, I found it hard to dig those memories up. After several weeks of writing this book, it all started flowing out, all the emotions and feelings I felt that night, and for many months after that. I had been asked to write this book for several years by multiple people, and the time was never right. Suddenly, one night, something just clicked in me, and I started writing and didn't stop for 3 months. When it comes down to this location, with all that has occurred there over the last 10 years, there are no good guys or bad guys in this story. Just different people with different belief systems that all made this place as haunted as it is, in my opinion. All these different types of energies collided in the spot that we call the House of Wills. I think it was meant to be that way, and it's quite possible that we all were predetermined to meet there. In some cosmic way, who knows if this location didn't draw all our different energies there to make it what it is today. It's almost like the House of Wills is a giant lighthouse drawing people closer to shore, like a lost ship in the night. The reason why I wrote this book, and why I believe I am qualified to do so, is that I spent many years listening to and investigating eyewitness reports from the House of Wills, not to mention my time spent at the actual location and my experiences that followed while at and after leaving the property. I spent 13 hours in person investigating the House of Wills, gathering evidence and firsthand accounts of what I witnessed with my team. I compiled what happened, from my perspective, after leaving the building, and what continued to occur over a period of 1 month after the visit. The story I am about to tell is completely true. It includes eyewitnesses and my own perspective of what led up to, occurred during, and followed the in-person investigation at the House of Wills. Some of what you are about to hear in this story may be disturbing. This is the story of my time spent at the House of Wills. Chapter 1. Where it all began. My journey into the world of paranormal investigating began in the fall of 2005, when my mother bought tickets to a local ghost hunt at Fort Delaware for me, herself, and my stepsister. I had never been on a ghost hunt before, and I had never lived through a paranormal experience I couldn't explain. I didn't even know what a ghost hunter was, or what they did. Don't get me wrong, I had some interest in the paranormal, but I was also a skeptic, as I still am to this day. I lived in a haunted house for several years, but have no memories of it because we moved when I was 6 years old. My parents told me stories of unexplained things that happened while we lived in the house. Furniture often moved around on its own, and my parents woke up to the contents of a dresser's drawers dumped on the floor multiple times. I didn't know what to expect when I decided to go on this new paranormal adventure at Fort Delaware. I thought it was going to be like the movies, where things fly across a room, or people are possessed by evil spirits. Maybe it would just be a bunch of people telling ghost stories while sitting around a campfire. To prepare, I brushed up on ghost hunting TV shows and was ready for the creepy music and cool equipment. The night finally came for our ghost hunt, and I was rather excited. Fort Delaware is on an island in the middle of the Delaware River, and you have to take a ferry to it. The fort that stands today was originally constructed to defend Philadelphia from the Confederate Navy during the Civil War. But in the first year of the war, the Confederate Navy was completely wiped out, and there was no need for the fort anymore. The Union decided to turn it into a prison camp for Confederate soldiers, and most of the soldiers held there were captured at the Battle of Gettysburg. It was quickly nicknamed the Andersonville of the North, after the notoriously bad Andersonville, Georgia Confederate prison camp, Camp Sumter, by the prisoners, for good reason. It was a late afternoon in October when we visited Fort Delaware, so by the time we boarded the ferry, it was almost dark out, and the island slowly disappeared into the dark of the night. I remember staring across the river from the ferry dock at the island that seemed so ghostly itself. We sat on the upper deck of the ferry for our 20-minute journey across the 2 miles of cold open water to the fort. I thought about how those prisoners must have felt as they made their way to the fort, not knowing if they would ever return to their homes in the South. It must have felt like they were in another world, being prisoners of war so far away from the South, where some had never left their home states until the war. When we got to the island, we were met by a park ranger who was behind the wheel of a large tractor pulling a covered wagon that seated about 20 people. We all piled onto the wagon and took our seats in excitement. We rode in the wagon for what seemed to be about a quarter of a mile. The suspense was starting to kick in, and we all waited to see what was in store for us. As we made our way through the trees, the fort gradually appeared. We were all taken aback by how ominous and big it really was. The pictures did it no justice. Large torches flanked both sides of a bridge that covered a large moat that surrounded the fort on all sides. We were met by another park ranger who walked us across a bridge, over a moat, and into a large sally port with winding stone stairs on one side. We were then led into a large football field-sized courtyard that was surrounded by 20-foot-high stone walls on all sides. On top of the walls were walkways from which guards watched over the prisoners. The energy and history of this place flooded me with every emotion. We were given a quick history lesson by the park ranger and shown into a rather large room, which the rangers referred to as the Union Soldiers' Mess Hall. Almost 100 people had turned out for this event. I was a little shocked that so many people wanted to hear ghost stories, but it was October, and everyone seemed to be in the spirit for scary stuff. We received another history lesson and broke up into smaller groups and headed out. A park ranger asked to see a show of hands of those who were signed up for the history tour. I looked around the room, and almost everyone had raised their hands except us and a couple. Then the park ranger asked for everyone to raise their hands if they were at the fort for the ghost hunt. Out of the 100 or so people in the room, only 5 of us raised our hands. The ranger pointed to an older gentleman on the other side of the room and told us he was our tour guide and resident ghost hunter in a slightly mocking tone. Back in 2005, ghost hunting and talking about the paranormal in public was still taboo. People were afraid of being laughed at or shunned for believing in ghosts. A lot has changed since then, thanks in part to TV shows such as Ghost Hunters, which paved the way for a new generation of paranormal enthusiasts. Ghost hunting has turned from taboo to Monday morning water cooler talk, or a weekend hobby for many. Many people today have a paranormal story to tell, even the skeptics. John was our tour guide, and if it wasn't for him, my career and this book would never have happened. John had us follow him outside to the courtyard and began to explain where we were headed as we walked across the yard to the far corner. I have heard the fort called everything from the dungeons to the catacombs and prison cells. John referred to it as the powder mag, which is from before it was a prison. This area was where the gunpowder was stored and where the armory was located. He told us that today, the powder mag was home to bats and the occasional muskrat from the surrounding marsh on the island. We made our way down a long, dark, winding corridor. The walls were just wide enough for us to walk single file. We eventually came to a larger room with high ceilings that smelled of musty gunpowder and urine. He told us that what we smelled were the remnants of a powder explosion that killed several Union soldiers. The smell of urine was from the prisoners that were kept there. There wasn't a designated area to relieve themselves, so they went wherever. He explained that human urine is very acidic, and it seeped into the brick and stone walls. The smell has been there since the fort was a prison, and most likely will never go away. John asked us to gather around as he started to tell us about his experiences in the powder mag. As we all stood in a semicircle to listen to John's stories, I saw something in my peripheral vision. As I turned to look in the direction of the movement, I was shocked to see a man standing in the hallway, staring at me. I then noticed the man had no lower half. All that was visible of the man was his shoulders and head. He was gray in color, with shoulder-length hair and a scraggly, dirty beard full of debris. At first, I thought it might be a reenactor or another tour guide, but the fact there was nothing from the shoulders down was not possible. I watched him for what seemed like minutes, but was only about 10 seconds. Then, it looked like he was sucked backward into a hole in the middle of the room, and he disappeared. I stood there quietly, in shock, and stared into the room, hoping to get another glimpse of him. I said nothing at the time it happened because I thought the others would think I was making it up, or that I was crazy. The man's face I saw that night has been etched into my memory. I can still describe him in detail, as if it only happened moments ago. I was excited and confused all at once during the ferry ride back to the mainland. I was excited that I had a paranormal experience, but also confused. Why did this man, who was obviously a Confederate prisoner of war, show himself to me, of all people? Was he some distant relative that was imprisoned there and tried to contact me? Or was I in the right place at the right time? When I got home, I lay in bed for hours and still saw the man's face and the expression of sorrow and defeat on it. I could tell he was in a bad way and he did not want to be there anymore. It saddened me to the core. I had little paranormal things here and there that had happened over the years, but it was very easy to explain or rationalize them. However, there was no dismissing this man I saw at the fort. I saw him as plain as day, 20 feet away from me. I knew from this point I was going to do my best to figure out what I experienced and why he chose me to show himself to. That was my first real paranormal experience, and it felt like finding the holy grail of the paranormal. Not to mention, it was my first ghost hunt, and I had an amazing experience that piqued my interest to a whole new level. All I knew from that point on was that I was hooked and had to figure all this out. I woke up the next morning with a newfound look at life. I knew nothing about how to investigate or use the equipment, but I did know one thing that night when I left. Some way and somehow, I was going to pursue this as my new hobby. I now had a mission to research and educate myself on the field of the paranormal, learn the techniques and how to use the equipment, and find places to investigate. I had no experience in hunting or investigating haunted locations, and it was all new to me, much like starting a new job where you knew nothing about the job or any of your coworkers. I had no one to partner with or mentor me. It was just me and my desire to take on something new that intrigued me. I started to research and read articles and went down the rabbit hole of the internet. Keep in mind, this was 2005, and I read random paranormal stories and saw pictures and videos that people had uploaded. I almost believed everything I saw. I will come across some of those pictures and videos now and just laugh at how naive I was back then. These days, you can't believe anything that you see online or on any of the social media platforms. In 2005, we did not have social media with all the different types of filters that can be used to create different effects that can fool people into seeing something that is not real. It makes it hard to take anyone's stories or paranormal evidence seriously when it's uploaded for the world to see. You almost need a degree in cinematography to weed out the fakes, since it's hard with the ever-changing world of technology. I frequented every bookstore in my area to find books on the paranormal and any type of literature or videos I could get my hands on. I started watching the TV shows about ghost hunting that were on at the time. I found the world of paranormal investigations exciting and interesting, and I loved the fact that sometimes they found nothing at all while investigating. That felt real and more believable, given that I had gone most of my life without any type of experience at all until that one night. As many of us did back in the day, I made the mistake of using the TV shows of the time to make my decisions for me. I started collecting whatever new gadget they had at the time, and most of the time I was disappointed in what I purchased and scratched my head over how some of this equipment actually worked or detected spirits. I did find some stuff useful and made the best of it. I started my investigations small and researched top haunted locations in my home state. This was harder than I thought because every time I reached out to a location to see about going there, I wouldn't get a response, or they had no contact information at all. After several months of trying to find my first location to investigate, I was almost to the point of giving up when someone suggested a place called Crybaby Bridge in Delaware. I look back at this now and cringe, because there is literally a Crybaby Bridge in every state. Some actually have more than one. But being a rookie investigator and having absolutely no luck on landing a location, I jumped on it. Plus, it was free and open to the public. Without knowing a whole lot about the location, I went on my first ghost hunt by myself due to the fact I did not know anyone else who was into the paranormal at the time. The bridge wasn't even on a map. I got directions off a local website and went with it. After several hours of driving the back roads in Lower Delaware in the middle of the night, I finally came across what looked to be the bridge. To this day, I'm still not sure if it was even the actual spot or not. Regardless, I parked my car on the side of the desolate road in the middle of nowhere and began my walk to the bridge about 100 yards away. I remember walking up to the bridge on that cold February night with high anxiety and the hope of experiencing what happened to me at the fort back in October. After reaching the bridge, I thought, what now? Do I just stand here and ask random questions out loud? Or should I ask for a certain person that allegedly passed away there? In the little bit of research I did prior to my visit, there were no names attached to the bridge. There was only a backstory with no real evidence or records it ever happened. It was all folklore at this point, with no real grounds for any of it. The story I read online stated a woman and her child had driven off the bridge one snowy night back in the 1970s and drowned in the river below. When I looked over the side of the bridge, there lay my first clue. It was all just a story. There was no river at all. It was a small stream you could step over without getting your shoes wet. I got my first taste of how stories can be diluted over the years of being passed down from person to person. Even though I was disappointed, I knew I had to try to make contact while I was there. Even though there was no raging river under the bridge, doesn't mean some poor woman and her child did not drive over it and perish below. The story I read said people who stop there can sometimes hear what sounds like a baby crying or a woman screaming. The first thing that popped into my head was that in the country, sometimes at night you will hear a fox screaming. It sounds a lot like a woman or a child screaming and will send a chill up your spine and make a person believe the worst is happening to some poor person in the woods. With that in the back of my mind, I decided to try an electronic voice phenomenon, EVP session. This was my first time using the recorder, and I was not that familiar with it. With much fumbling around in the dark, I finally figured it out and began to record my questions for the spirits that were rumored to be there. My questioning process was much like watching a 1950s black and white detective show, where some poor person is being interrogated under a bright light with some three-piece suit-wearing, chain-smoking detective grilling them for answers. I look back on it and laugh at how green and inexperienced I was at the time, and how far I have come since that night. After spending close to an hour on the bridge and exploring the area, I noticed how cold it was and decided to end my EVP session and head back to the car. Once I arrived back at the car, I listened to my recorder to see if I caught anything while I waited for the engine to warm up. I sat there listening to myself ramble on and the sounds of the trees and rustling high grass in the cold night, and decided to stop the recording and finish it at home. In the almost 2 hours I had been out there, not one car had passed over the bridge. Maybe that was what made this place so spooky and how all this folklore began. Almost every small town has its own scary road that the local teenagers swear is haunted, or if you travel that road at a certain time of night, you will be attacked by an evil monster looking to sacrifice any unwilling traveler daring to go down it late at night. We had our own place just like that, called Devil's Road. My high school friends and I would go out there on Friday nights and try to scare one another and any poor kid that decided to hang out with us. After I arrived back home, I sat down and listened to the rest of the recording. By the time I reached the end, I was disappointed I had not heard any voices besides my own, but I was not discouraged. I was new to this and knew it would take time for me to learn and master my skills. But quite honestly, in this business, there are no masters or experts. You're constantly learning new things and trying to better yourself. Fast forward a few years later, I investigated every local haunt I could gain access to. I started dating my now wife, Melanie, in late 2008, and she had always been interested in the paranormal, but had never ventured to a haunted location. We hit the road every other weekend and tried to find new haunted places to check out. One of our favorite spots was Gettysburg, Pennsylvania, where we had many interesting experiences and captured a lot of paranormal activity, such as EVPs and pictures that were unexplainable. We stayed in almost every bed and breakfast in the area at one point or another. One of our favorite places to stay was the Cashtown Inn, not just for its paranormal activity, but also its history and beauty. One time we rented one whole floor to ourselves for 5 days and brought my mother and my oldest son Nicholas along. Between investigating and holding down a busy family life with work and kids, we went to other locations like Moundsville, West Virginia's State Penitentiary and Hinsdale House. We helped local teams on their investigations and helped local homeowners with whatever paranormal activity was going on in their properties. Times were fun, and we met new people all the time who were just like us. In return, we built a network of connections that I still use to this very day. In 2011, I started my own team, which I named Breaking Paranormal. I wanted to expand, explore larger locations, and travel farther into other states. I teamed up with Stephanie and Greg, who were from Akron, Ohio, whom I had met on social media.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.